Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the 2021 economy, sorry, the fifth meeting of 2021 for the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item three, which is consideration of evidence in private. Are we content to do that? Yeah, thank you. So our main item of business this morning is an evidence session on support for economic recovery. I thank the panel for joining us today, and I would like to welcome Charles Hammond, who is Chief Executive of Forceports, Ewan MacDonald-Russell, Head of Policy and External Affairs with the Scottish Retail Consortium, Martin Reid, Director of Scotland and Northern Ireland Road Haulage Association, and Andrew Richards, Member of the Construction Scotland Industry Leadership Group from Construction Scotland. Welcome everybody. The purpose of today's evidence session is to consider what policies and actions are needed to promote economic recovery as we come through a very difficult period. Our evidence today will also help inform our consideration of the Scottish Government's budget for 2022-23. So welcome, panel. I would first of all like to ask a question on road haulage to Martin. I mean, at the moment, Martin, you can't read the news or, you know, open a newspaper without reading about the difficulties that are in haulage and supply issues. It does have significant coverage at the moment, and we're familiar with the debates around shortage of drivers and other issues. Could you say to what extent is this an issue that is particularly sharp in the UK and in Scotland, or if we are experiencing this a pressure that is felt across the rest of the EU?
I think it's fair to say that it's pretty acute over here, and there are very few supply chains that are not affected in one way or another. It would be, again, fair to say that it's not one particular factor that's caused this, but a number of contributors. Obviously, we've had the changes from the 1st of January. We estimated that pre-January, we were, as an industry, about 50,000 to 60,000 drivers short at that time. We also had about 15,000 EU nationals working in and out of the UK. Some of them went home with no intention of coming back. Others, it was difficult for them to come back. We also had COVID, which was a major issue, which meant that DVSA, who would normally put through about 75,000 HGV tests per year, were unable to operate at the same levels. And so we reckon around about 35,000 tests took place. Now, the pass rate is just slightly above 50%. So those two factors there make a difference. We also have legislation that came in surrounding IR35 and self-employment. And again, a number of the EU nationals that came in would do so as self-employed or agency workers. And so the changes that came there in terms of their tax status, etc., meant that they would either renegotiate higher rates or just not do it because there's easier work to be had on the continent without the bureaucracy and hassle that comes along with working in the UK. So I guess those are three factors. We also have an ageing workforce, and have done for many, many years. The average age of an HGV driver is around about 55 years old. So we have a lot of levers, whether that be through finding another career, whether it be retirement or ill health. And it's traditionally been very difficult to attract new blood into the industry. There's only 2% of the industry, our HGV drivers are under 25 years old. So these are all factors that have come to a head, along with many others that I'm sure the other candidates will speak about that's added to the issues. But at the minute, around about, you know, 85 to 90%, maybe more than that, of every good that's delivered, consumed, worn, eaten, etc., spends some time in the back of a truck. So the shortage that the industry is feeling is being felt right the way through many, many supply chains.
Thank you. In the previous Parliament, I was on the European Committee, and at the time we heard concerns that the road haulage sector had about what the rules were going to be under leaving the EU and concerns that this would have a negative impact. Since then, we've had COVID that's added to the pressures, and you've described how everything has come to a head at once. I suppose the first question is, when do you think this can be resolved? Is it going to get worse before it gets better?
Well, that, again, that's a really difficult question to answer, but I guess what I would say was, if we're not getting access to the labour markets that we had before, then it takes time to grow your own wood, if you like. So right across the UK and certainly in Scotland, there's training going on left, right and centre to either upskill existing workers or to bring new drivers into the industry. And through the apprenticeship scheme that's available, we are a number of trainers that are trying to bring new blood into the industry. So these things are going on right across the UK, but they do take time. So we have short term issues, medium term, and long term aspirations. But I don't see things improving any certainly for the next short term. No.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Reid. Other members will want to pick up on some of the issues you've identified this morning. Can I turn to Ewan MacDonald Russell? It's a very specific question, Ewan. It's about the you have a budget proposals. You have made recommendations for the 22-23 Scottish budget around how to support the retail sector. Can you maybe give us an idea of what are the key measures? What are the key challenges you face at the moment? What are the key measures you would look for in the budget to ease some of the challenges that you're facing?
Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to speak this morning. To answer those questions in turn, the first one really about the challenges. The COVID pandemic has absolutely smashed the Scottish retail industry. Our sales 18 months on remain below pandemic levels. Footfall is a fifth below pandemic levels in town and city centres. We reckon physical shops, because they were closed for so long, missed out on something like £4.5 billion. Now, that's been incredibly difficult, and I don't need to kind of exaggerate the realities. We've all seen the high streets, the big shops that sadly no longer trade because of that. In terms of, you know, all that happening, what we would say firstly is that government, both at Westminster and at Holyrood, has done immense work to support us, and in particular, the business rates relief in the last 2 years has been fundamental to many shops surviving. That's been huge. A business rates therefore segues into the budget. We obviously wouldn't anticipate a similar 100% reduction next year. I don't think that's feasible or realistic for the public finances, but some sort of modest reduction from what, rather the return to full 100% rates, particularly for those retailers who are still recovering, it is probably our big ask. On top of that, though, we remain concerned about consumer demand and consumer spending. It's still pretty sluggish. We know retail sales are very sluggish. We may come on to inflation later, and that challenge is really real in that. And I guess it's if there's measures that firstly protect consumers. So we've asked that there be no increase in income tax rates for low and medium earners, and that's been a priority for us for some years because those people tend to have less discretionary spend. But furthermore, that idea about can we take action to stimulate growth? Can we get people back to town and city centres safely? In Northern Ireland, they brought in a voucher scheme to encourage people back to physical shops. That's the sort of idea we'd be really interested in exploring, particularly as we kind of come into the crucial golden quarter of trading.
Okay, thank you. I understand Colin Smith had questions on retail. I'll bring in Colin.
Thanks very much, Claire. Yeah, can I just follow up on the question from Claire Ewan on retail? I mean, how great are these short-term supply challenges that retailers face in terms of stock level? I mean, what does this mean for families as we gear up to Christmas? Are we going to have particular shortages of any items on our high streets?
We can't hear Ewan, if the microphone could be...
Thank you, Convener. Apologies, Colin. I was speaking in the wilderness for a moment. Martin explained that the reasons why the kind of shortages have come in from HGV drives, we'd acknowledge that. In the short term, that's providing huge structural challenge, keeping stores stocked. A lot of retailers already, you'll notice, are prioritising, ensuring that they have kind of lines in place over specific products. So you might see a certain product line won't have the range and choice we'd have. That's something that at the moment, unless we see action on, for example, visas for EU HGV drivers, something we may have to live with in the run up to Christmas, and something that becomes, quite frankly, harder as we come into Christmas because volumes going into store go up. So that's on a kind of grocery side. more broadly on non-food lines, particularly kind of Christmas presents, there's a real challenge. Retailers will be absolutely desperate to get every product into store. It's, as I mentioned, the big trading period of the year. But there are huge international challenges. Shipping costs are up. Shipping makers have been disrupted by the pandemic and a huge amount of other things as global challenges. But when combined with the problems with HGV and indeed with the ongoing economic challenges, it's going to be really hard. I think, you know, we've been quite candid that if people are preparing for Christmas, then this is a pretty good year to be organising your Christmas shopping.
Thank you very much, Ewan. That's obviously a big problem for me as a Christmas Eve shopper. But I mean, is this the new normal? I mean, are the challenges that we face, frankly, in many cases here to stay? I mean, is this going to be rethinking the just-in-time stock approach? Are we going to be basically? I mean, what does this mean also for our high streets as well? You walk down any high street at the moment, and it can be quite a depressing experience with shop closures. I mean, are these long-term challenges, or is it a short-term phenomenon?
I think what we're seeing at the moment partly is a culmination of years of kind of pressures building on the retail industry. So we've been saying for years that the impacts of the cost of running property, the cost of employing people, those things would come to a head when digital technology kind of hit into it. The pandemic, of course, created a perfect opportunity for that. At one point, digital sales were up to 65%. So they've dropped back to about 40 now. So there's been that kind of pressure on the retail model, on the store side of it. And then all these kind of supply chain challenges are coming through because the competition, the way the industry's worked, has meant that there's never really been any slack in that. Retailers, producers, all these businesses are running really lean operations with pretty minimal profitability, to be honest. So when these economic shocks, and COVID is a huge economic shock in that way, they're sort of rippling through, and we're seeing those consequences coming to a head. I would caution that, you know, in retail, we're probably very much at the apex of that challenge. I would hope that moving forward, as the industry adapts, as it, you know, the businesses that are there are able to become more productive, our models hopefully should be able to adjust and adapt, accepting that in the short term, we're really, really struggling. And indeed, this week, the CO2 challenges indicate just how little slack there is in the system. But that may have impacts upon the wider economy, and particularly if we see lots of different measures and costs coming in, it's going to be very hard for those costs not to be passed on to consumers in the future. That's something we really want to avoid, but it's looking harder and harder to avoid that.
Okay, I'll bring in Maggie Chapman, then I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Claire. Thank you for what you've said so far, Ewan. I wonder if you could just say a little bit more about how you and the businesses that the retailers that you support and work with see the changing nature of the high street. And I know that pre-pandemic we saw quite significant moves around local identity and placemaking in the high street. But I wondered in the same way as you were talking about protecting and encouraging consumers back into the high street, what is it that we should be doing to support and encourage local businesses, local retailers, to generate sort of places that people want to be? Because I think it's not only about financial incentives to get consumers back on the high street, it's about placemaking. And I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts about the changing nature of the high street is.
Thank you. It's a fabulous question. And the answer is there isn't a one-size-fits-all approach that works for different areas and different places. If you look at some of the places in Scotland that are amazing at this, they don't necessarily are the big shopping centres, but they've got either they'll have some sort of natural asset. Off the top of my head, St Andrews has come to mind with a huge golf course at the university, a very unique example. But you see lots of town cities where they've got that kind of distinct identity, where there's a good reason. But I'd say that from a customer perspective, what consumers are really looking for is it easy to get there, whether that's private, whether that's public transport, but it's about making sure they can get to there. We wouldn't take a view on how, about that kind of, what are the other reasons to go? And I think also accepting that what the retail offering looks like in different towns and cities is not going to be perhaps how it was 5-10 years ago, where we used to have, I would say, a relatively identikit approach. That's because a UK retailer 10 years ago would have needed 600 shops to have a nationwide presence. They probably now need something like 150 shops to the UK-wide presence, and they may not even need that many because of the way digital interacts. So it's about those businesses that find that unique opportunity. And from a retail perspective, it's what can I do that's great? And firstly, can I do it physically? But actually, is digital working for me too? We see digital on one hand as this terrible threat to the high street. But of course, if you've got a great proposition, it gives you a huge customer base too. And I guess just to kind of come back to that town and city centre's principle. It's good planning, it's clear vision. It doesn't always just have to be retail, it's what are the other things? Are there great hospitality options? Are there visitor attractions, museums or parks? But it's having that reason to go there. And I think, you know, retail alone is certainly not going to be the answer. And there's going to be fewer shops in the future as well, albeit hopefully we've passed the crest of the wave.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. My questions are for Charles Hammond of Forth Ports. I wanted to ask you about an article you had on the Forth Ports website of June 2020, where you called on the UK government to have a national resilience strategy. And within that article, you said, we need a long-term strategy underpinned by in-depth analysis that examines a range of weaknesses from the frailties of our supply chains, future skill shortages, to the residual capability required to maintain critical supplies. So my question would be, what's changed in the last 15 months to address these issues you highlighted last year, and what would be the role of Scotland's ports in dealing with the frailties of our supply chains?
Okay, thanks very much for the question. Good morning, convener, ladies and gentlemen. I made that comment as the chair of the UK Major Ports Group as well, and I think we were in the height of the pandemic at the time, and we were starting to see, I should say, first of all, I want to thank all the operators in our industry, particularly across the UK, for delivering out essential goods and supplies during the pandemic. I think that's a good starting point. We started to see a build-up in stocks in our ports. And I think you can almost look at the ports as our sort of last line of defence. We need to keep operating, get goods on the supermarket shelves, but we also need to keep operating as well to make sure that Scottish exports get out to markets. So our answer to that was to continue to invest. But since I made that comment, and we obviously run Grangemouth as Scotland's largest port, handles a big percentage of Scotland's GDP. Since that point, we've commissioned new warehousing, satellite storage areas, a training centre at Grangemouth, and a new rail terminal. So I think the answer from the ports industry is to create more capacity. We are probably on average holding double the amount of stock of goods that we were holding pre-pandemic because people are moving, we think, from a just-in-time supply chain to a just-in-case supply chain. They want to know goods are on the quayside and we are distributing those goods when there are slots in warehouses. I also made the comment because I'm consciously aware of the shortage of HGV drivers as well. And one of the things we've tried to do is to manage the peaks with the driver shortage by extending our operating hours so that we can receive goods at all hours, particularly again for exports. So I would tend to agree with what Martin said, there's no quick fix. But one of the things I'd like to highlight, as well as having a training centre, we're talking to the Scottish Government about creating a simulator centre beside the training centre. We have one of these down at Tilbury for returning ex-servicemen for apprenticeships. And it does occur to me that some simulator training may also help with the HGV training problem as well. So that would be one measure that we would be keen to get implemented as soon as possible. This was funded through LIBOR, so it's a charitable trust down at Tilbury. Something similar could be done at in Scotland, and the investment would be probably around about £1 million to £1.5 million and would complement the training facilities we already have. So sorry, a slightly long-winded answer to your question, but I think the short answer is be operationally more efficient, create more capacity and continue to invest.
You quite rightly said that Grangemouth carries a large proportion of Scotland's GDP through its port. I think it's about 30%, and about 70% of Scotland's population lives within 1 hour of Grangemouth. The last time the committee examined this issue, We visited Grangemouth, I think it was back in 2015, and we were concerned that investment in poor infrastructures lagged far behind that of continental Europe in terms of handling of containers. And I'm just wondering if you could say a wee bit more about the level of investment you've put into Grangemouth in recent years, given the £1 billion you've invested into Tilbury in the last 8 years.
Yes, I mean, in terms of the container terminal itself, I mean, we've got round about £250 million of projects across all our ports. Since you visited, I would say the investment at Grangemouth has certainly been over £50 million, with some of the investments I've highlighted. There's an ongoing programme of investment for equipment, and it's probably worth my saying that we didn't agree with that observation at the time. We felt we were well invested and we would continue to invest and provide more capacity, craneage, straddle carriers, warehousing, rail terminals, and we've continued to do that on an ongoing basis. But we did point out to the committee at the time that the productivity at Grangemouth, as Scotland's largest port, is...
It's frozen.
Mr. Hammond, we have a problem with your connection at the moment. We'll try to resolve that.
Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you now. If you want, we did miss the last few sentences of what you had to say recently. If you want to just maybe return to Gordon's question.
Sorry, I'm not quite sure how much of it you caught, but my answer was effectively, we've invested significantly in capacity at Grangemouth, over £50 million. And I just wanted to make the point as well that the productivity at the container terminal at Grangemouth is better than a number of continental ports. So we feel we are well invested. We're almost in a continuous building programme of warehousing capacity. We can take the longest trains in the UK, and we have adequate craneage and resources for handling the peaks of anything that's thrown at us just now. And we've also invested recently in a border control post in readiness for Brexit as well. So quite a significant level of investment since you last visited.
So my last question is about Leith. So evidence in previous parliamentary sessions has suggested that a lack of capacity in Scotland has contributed to the holding back the development of a Scottish supply chain in renewable energy, particularly in relation to onshore and offshore wind. Does the proposed development at Leith address the capacity issue, or do other gaps remain?
A lot depends on the frequency of development of offshore wind. I think Leith goes a substantial way towards addressing that capacity issue. And I say that because we're about to finish the first purpose-built renewable site in any Scottish port at Dundee. Leith will replicate what we have at Dundee, so we'll have two renewables hubs, and there are obviously facilities elsewhere as well at NIG, and a number of facilities planned. The real game changer at Leith is the fact we're releasing 150 acres of cleared land for manufacturing, supply chain, and also start-up businesses. So the local content that we're all looking for, particularly in the Gotwind leasing round and some earlier developments, can happen at Leith. So I would say a lot depends on the supply chain and the pace of development, but Leith will make a substantial inroad into that. And it's important we get that development off the ground as soon as we possibly can.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Jamie Halcrow-Johnson to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I've got a number of questions for different panellists. So if I could start again with Charles Hammond, just on the points that you've made there. We've obviously seen over the last few years a number of Scotland's ports and harbours specialising in certain areas, whether it's freight or tourism or fishing or renewables. Do you think there is a coordinated enough plan for Scotland in terms of what what the country needs from its port infrastructure or harbour infrastructure, you know, or is the kind of approach that each will prioritise a sector, you know, working kind of well enough?
I need to be careful in how I answer this question, because 75% of the port industry is now in private hands, but there are fewer private operators in Scotland. So I think what I would say is that port operators are perfectly capable of investing in their own port infrastructure. And the cost of money, the attraction of capital into the ports industry is not a problem. Across the UK, we attract capital from overseas, from the Commonwealth, from the US, with long-term pension-based shareholders. So investment capacity is really not an issue. In terms of coordinating infrastructure, my view is that infrastructure has to be built against the market demand and a proper understanding of the market that you're operating in. And as long as you're doing that, then I think there is a level of cooperation for ports who are infrastructure ready, particularly in renewables, because we will get delays in the supply chain and people can work together to try and iron out these delays. We're actually doing that at the moment with NIG. So I think it's difficult to say it should be more coordinated, but I do think the Scottish Government have to take a more, I suppose, holistic view of what's going on and then encourage investment in infrastructure and ports, because the capital is there to do so for the right markets.
Thank you for that. Just on, in terms of your own kind of opinions of the both your market here in the UK, but also more globally, I think the suggestion was that the volume of trade coming through, or sorry, volume of freight coming through UK ports was down 10% in the first two quarters of this year compared to 2019. Has there been a reduction in global freight capacity? I mean, in terms of, are there fewer ships operating? Are there fewer containers available to use? And has that been part of the kind of increasing pressure on availability and prices?
I do think when you look at container freight rates, so to give you an example, the cost of moving a container from the Far East into Europe has gone up from, in the last 18 months, from something like a couple of $1,000 to nearly $20,000. So deep sea lines are pretty much at the moment at capacity, but also extremely profitable. Ports are starting globally to get to capacity as well because of this just-in-case mentality. So when you take the effect of the pandemic, people thinking about stockpiling for Brexit, but also the disruption in the supply chain, which the grounding in the Suez Canal caused, there are, you know, the container shipping market is at capacity, and therefore it's important for the ports to release more capacity in that particular market. And that's what we've been trying to do, if you like, at Grangemouth, to make sure the supply chain continues to run smoothly. But I would say that some of the bigger players globally are starting to look at their own shipping solutions to try and get around that capacity. So markets usually do find a way, and things are not log jammed yet. We may be at greater capacity than we were before the pandemic, but the operations generally across the UK, as far as I can see, and in Scotland, are working satisfactorily at the moment.
Thank you for that. I know my colleagues will come further on that. So if I could turn some questions to Ewan in terms of the SRC. Charles Hammond's just talked there about just-in-time, a shift from just-in-time to just-in-case. Do you see that becoming an issue for your members as well? You know, the old traditional storage above a shop or depositories, can you see that becoming more of an issue where more is being stockpiled?
Thanks. I think there's huge challenges in moving to that model because of the sort of inherent cost that it comes to it. The reason for having just-in-time isn't just because it's kind of, it makes us look at it. It's that efficiency in the system has two big effects. Firstly, it reduces waste enormously, and that's both sustainability good, but of course, bluntly, economically, it makes a huge difference in that it just allows everything to run more efficiently. But if you're talking about creating warehouse space, warehouse space has actually been at a premium over the last couple of years anyway, for various reasons which you've articulated. So actually moving to that model has pretty significant cost changes. I guess there's a caveat to that, that as we shift more and more to online, particularly in non-food, particularly in certain categories, to a degree that can happen easier because we're not really putting stuff above shops. Indeed, storage space in shops is pretty much at a minimum because you want it in single big distribution hub. So I guess you might see some sort of element to that, but I think it again comes back to that, how much cost do we want to add into the model, and then where does that cost concurrently fall? And that's why I think there'd be a bit of resistance, that it's almost an attempt to how can we improve, how can we repair the system we've got, rather than necessarily wanting to wholesale change things.
Thank you. Can I just ask, in terms of the supply lines and stock availability, because we talk about supply lines like it's one, you know, it just happens within the United Kingdom. Particularly, say, for example, toys, because there's been a huge amount of press coverage about Christmas and toys availability. You know, are there issues here in terms of manufacturing abroad, the actual transport of the of products to the United Kingdom, the cost, you know, increased cost of manufacturing abroad, and also, you know, are there cases now where some of your members just simply recognise that the price of something now is not suitable for the UK market? How is all of that impacting on what might or might not be available?
Yeah, I mean, firstly, you're completely correct. There are global prices, global commodity changes that are driving an awful lot of these things, and capacity and demand from across the world. The way that we've seen, particularly kind of with the impact of the pandemic on different nations, how they're operating, all those changes have shifted those demand opportunities. In terms of products, it ultimately it's really consumer driven. I know that seems like a sort of pop out. It's not so much. It's that if consumers continue to really want things, continue to pay for things, retailers will find a way to do that. It's really whether those prices remain stationary. I certainly know that the August CPI figures showed that things were going up. We were seeing toys, electricals, those kind of global prices are coming up. Those prices will, I suspect, eventually be passed along. Whether we see that in food is a different question. I think there's distinct reasons to be very nervous about food inflation, because of course that's inherently regressive when it happens. Bank of England, of course, is quite confident that there's a lot of transitory pressures. Things will peak around the end of the year, and I very much hope they're correct. We're a bit nervous. There's some quite structural things coming in, particularly we have particular labour shortages, partly in the UK at the moment, although it's not unique here. Those do tend to kind of drive up costs overall. So that would be our nervousness around the cost impacts coming through.
Thank you very much. I have one more question, and if I can ask it to Andrew Richards, and it's just a very kind of brief question, because I know Fiona Hislop, I think, is going to talk about this, or certainly other panellists are, as other members of the committee are. There's an unpredictability about the residential and commercial kind of property market at the moment. So I just wanted to know where you see, from a construction point of view, the sector kind of going over the next few years in terms of where the opportunities to build will be, and how that kind of demand or perhaps lack of demand in some cases will be met or addressed or dealt with.
Okay. Good morning. Can you hear me okay?
Hear you fine. Thank you.
Super. Okay. Good morning, everybody. It's interesting. I mean, the demand profile in, I guess, globally and also locally is really quite strange in that I suppose demand globally, most countries have got projects that are way behind where they should be because of the COVID pandemic. You've got projects that were already coming through the pipeline that have continued to come through the pipeline. And then you've got a number of countries who are seeing construction as a route to improving their economies from a COVID recession, accelerating projects. So there is a massive increase in demand for construction globally, which inevitably causes an impact with supplies globally as well. And obviously Scotland is not immune to that whatsoever. There are more local issues, in that a lot of construction products and materials are not actually made in Scotland, and they are imported either from England, Europe, or wider than that, and they are obviously not manufactured in Scotland. I guess the other thing that you've got going on is you've got a very rigorous standards regime in terms of all the components and products that are used within construction that obviously have to pass huge amounts of testing. Obviously Grenfell aside, but obviously that has a has quite a bearing in terms of actually what can ultimately be supplied. And I guess you've also got a low cost procurement regime where you have got an industry that is constantly trying to beat itself up against each other to actually try and win work, and it's almost killing itself by trying to actually win work. And that's even sort of, I suppose, the frailties of the COVID pandemic. Sorry, the frailties of the industry have been highlighted by the pandemic, and actually it's quite interesting that you have actually got an industry that actually isn't going to be transformative as you would want it to be, but yet it's got a huge amount of demand. So residential markets, both the affordable side and the private sales side in Scotland, are actually really quite buoyant. The same applies in Scotland in terms of older projects that are still being finalised and built. In the construction phase that are struggling in terms of supplies, you've got your current projects and then you've got your additional projects. You've got additional demands coming through in terms of net zero carbon and carbon reducing measures in terms of retrofit and not just new build, it's taking the existing buildings and actually trying to improve them as well. So it kind of the demand side of things, Jamie, is huge, and actually the issues that we're dealing with are probably more supply based issues in terms of actually just where we're getting that product from and actually how we get that product into and onto our sites.
That's super. Thank you.
Reasonable prices.
Thank you very much for that. I better let other committee members come in, but thank you for the input on that.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, and thanks for joining us this morning. I've got my initial questions for Andrew Richards from Construction Scotland, but I will want to come to all the panel about the cumulative impact of supply chain pressures and resilience planning, just mitigations immediately, but also for the future. But to start with Andrew, first of all, can I just thank Construction Scotland for your hard work during the pandemic and continuing for safety measures during the pandemic. But I'm very conscious that, as you've just set out, that for many countries, and including in this country, that construction can be seen and is a way to drive economic recovery. So I want to explore a bit more some of what you've just been setting out, and please feel free to set it out in more detail with examples of the impacts that you're currently seeing of supply chain pressures on our drive to try and secure more economic recovery through construction. To Andrew.
Okay. A specific example, I suppose, is with net zero, everyone's talking about air source heat pumps and you're using hydrogen as an energy supply rather than actually gas and electricity even. That in itself creates an issue in terms of actually where do we get all the components for air source heat pumps, for example, and there isn't other than Mitsubishi in Livingston any other area in Scotland that actually produces these technologies, and they don't do enough for everything that we require in Scotland. But actually, the wider issues that are never really thought through is actually when you're using an air source heat pump, you actually need bigger radiators. Nobody in the world currently is actually making the radiators that you actually need to heat homes and offices, because the traditional size of radiators don't get hot enough through those measures. So and what's, I guess, ultimately driving this, understand what the particularly the public sector, but also the private sector demands are in respect of net zero. Net zero is so wide in terms of what people actually want. So You've not got the investment in manufacturing delivering exactly what we need, because there's just everyone that knows and understands. Obviously, we've got COP26 coming. That it's absolutely right on the tip of everyone's tongue in terms of what we need to be doing, in terms of we want to have this aspiration of being net zero. But actually, how that equates to itself in terms of buildings and actually how that equates itself into a proposition that makes somebody want to invest in Scotland to actually build those sorts of radiators actually has to have a demonstrable pipeline of opportunities for the next 10 to 15 years. And without that, actually, you're not going to get the business case for manufacturing capability to be sort of reinvented ultimately in Scotland. So there's these are the sorts of challenges that are happening regularly in terms of actually we kind of think we know what we want, but we kind of don't actually move the industry forward in a transformative way, partly because of that uncertainty. But the other issue is that the industry, as I sort of highlighted to Jamie before, is such a low margin industry. And the way in which construction is procured is that actually it does force the industry into trying to chase work at lower and lower margins and lower cost. And actually that just does not leave any slack in the system for investing in itself, for actually finding new ways, because actually there's a race to the bottom going on currently, because procurement on the basis of massive amounts of risk transfer to the public sector, to private sector from the public sector, and also lowest cost always prevails, forces people into actually taking whatever shortcuts they possibly can to actually try and win that work. And that more often than not actually involves going to try and source as many of your materials from places that aren't in Scotland at all, and that they're much further afield. And actually, you know, when you're trying to drive ultimately, I guess, the circular economy, you're absolutely not you're doing the complete opposite with a procurement regime that exists as it does.
So there's something about the construction sector being a source of resilience, but also transformation. But there are real challenges in the supply chain to deliver that. Is that your message to us?
Yeah, I mean, certainly, I mean, you know, obviously you need money to transform, and you need to actually be in a pretty healthy position to be able to actually start investing in yourself. And the position actually has been, I guess, you know, exposed ultimately by COVID in terms of just how weak the industry is. But actually, it would love to be in a much stronger position to actually be able to invest in itself and actually try and move itself forward. But actually, the procurement regime actually hinders rather than actually helps with this sort of transformation. The other issue you've actually got, and it was, I guess, sort of touched upon in earlier conversations, is that these things can't just be changed overnight. You can't just suddenly grow more trees. You can't suddenly just come up with new innovative technology that doesn't have to go through rigorous testing. So, you know, a lot of the resilience that we've actually got is almost having to look at it from a medium to longer term rather than actually having anything that literally we can. We set up a material shortages working group with the government, and it was headed, or it still is, there's another two weeks to go, headed by Ivan McKee. And it's done a hell of a lot in terms of actually just understanding the position that we have in terms of the shortages. But actually, the one thing that with all the discussions that have happened with key material manufacturers and suppliers in Scotland is it's highlighted the fact that actually you can't do what you did with PPE, which is actually try and divert resources that are currently being used elsewhere to actually try and give you what you want, because of the components that are used in construction are so complex and so well tested, is that actually just it's just not the same at all. So we do have a short-term problem that we are actually recognizing and knowing that we've actually got to try and address through budgets and other means. But actually the longer term is actually using COVID positively as a catalyst to actually trying to get some of the transformative
Andrew, we're getting a bit of buffering, I think, from you just now. Just hang on a second, we'll try and get you. Is that okay? Can we now?
Connection. If Mr. Top, if you want to move on to
we'll try and get Andrew back. But the question I wanted to ask all the members of the panel was the cumulative impact currently of supply chain issues across the different sectors. What can be done to mitigate that, and also what resilience planning that you are aware of, either at Scottish Government level or also UK Government level. I'm conscious I've got three of the supermarket distribution warehouses in my constituency, very aware of the cumulative impact potentially of whether it's of COVID, but also of Brexit, labour supply, etc. So if you can think about it in terms of some of the immediate interrelationships you have and what could be done to help mitigate some of the immediate issues, and then also if you can think about what we need to do to build in resilience to what we're experiencing just now for the future. And then we'll come back to Andrew, who have now, I'm glad we've got you back, Andrew, but we're just going to move on to the panel view on that cumulative concurrent interrelationship of those pressures and what can we do to build in resilience to the sectors. So I don't know, Martin, we haven't heard you for a while, so maybe you want to, is there anything that the other sectors can do to help you, or what do you see in terms of resilience planning that's needed?
Yeah, thank you for coming to me, Minister. We kind of, as we're all finding out now, are the glue that helps, that keeps the other sectors together. That's not to say that it's now being recognised just how important the sector is. I mean, the UK logistics sector employs 2.54 million people, and it's worth £127 billion to the public purse. We have a number of requests into the government, some short term, as I pointed out, some medium and some long term. At the minute, we need short term answers to fulfil existing orders. And that we have asked that the government look at temporary or seasonal visas to allow access to different markets. We've looked at things like expanding existing, like the youth mobility scheme, in order to help bring people back in. But I guess one of the issues, the perennial issues that we've faced, is the image of the industry itself. And we could be bringing a lot of people who have left the industry back in on the short term to help with the existing problems. And we've asked for example, a review of CPC. We've asked for, we put a proposal into the government, which we called One for One, which would be, rather than having a block of five CPC days before coming in, then one day could work for 1 year on a temporary basis. So these proposals are already in. But yes, we can ask for help from a number of different quarters for help with the image of the industry. And we as an industry have had to hold ourselves under the microscope and look at terms and conditions, wages, etc. But the feedback that we're getting is that the wages, although very welcome the additional money that's coming in for the wages, is that that's not necessarily the major problem in attracting people back into the industry. And part of that is largely around how drivers are treated on the road network and within the delivery and pickup scenarios. So, I totally understand what Andrew was saying there about the race to the bottom in terms of money, but also the legislation side of things as well. So drivers have to look at are covered by the driver's hours regulations as well as the working time directive. They've got legal requirements in terms of how they operate their tachographs and also just basically how they go about their business, the time they're allowed to work, the time they're allowed to drive. And what we're finding as the microscope is shone on all aspects of how we're doing things is that the efficiencies are being missed because of the amount of delays that are happening at pickup and drop-off. Now, that's right across the board. So we've worked very closely with Charles and his colleagues at Force Ports on the vehicle booking system, and that's been largely successful. There are obviously times when faults on both sides that could be remedied, but the same goes with the retail distribution centres. The governments from both countries were keen to label HCV drivers as key employees at the start of the pandemic because it was them that was keeping the PPE, the pharmaceuticals, etc., moving around the country. But we're still finding scenarios where the drivers are denied welfare facilities, and we're also in fairly unreasonable delays in terms of loading and unloading at certain places, and also not a lot of flexibility on the time slots. For example, if something's happened on the roads that facilitates a delay and they miss the slot, and they could often be waiting a couple of hours to do the same, which impinges on the working time directive, the driver's hours regulations, etc., 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 and means that the trucks are not running as efficiently. So we as an industry have to look at ourselves. The wider industry who we're delivering to need to look at themselves, but also we need help from the government on a number of different things. We lag so far behind the rest of Europe when it comes to welfare facilities on the network, safe and secure parking overnight. Freight crime has been growing again over the past few years, and curtainsiders are seen as an easy target when they're resting up. So we need safe and secure facilities on the network, and that's something that the Scottish Government could help with us put pressure on the UK Government to deliver.
Thank you very much.
These are things that we... Yeah.
Sorry. Thanks, Martin. If we can maybe move on to Charles. You already talked about some of the practical things you're doing, particularly with, I think, the HGV side of things, but I'm interested in your view of interdependencies and also resilience planning, whether you think it's satisfactory or do we need to do more in that area?
I think in terms of the immediate situation, we're doing pretty much all we can, and Martin highlighted things like vehicle booking systems. These are all designed to make the flow of information as efficient as we possibly can get it in the supply chain, extending capacity, satellite storage, more warehousing, and in fact, using the ports more flexibly, almost as trading zones. These are all things which will, I think, help us get through the immediate issue. I think when you look more longer term, one of the things I'd like to see is the government highlighting transport and logistics across all the industries as a good career to go into and something that people should be encouraged to go into, because it can be a rewarding career, it can be a long-term career, and it's not seen necessarily as aspirational or attractive at the moment, but to fix this longer term. And I say that because with the best will in the world in Scotland, we're a small economy and we're a little bit peripheral to the main markets of Europe. And that means that we have to be even more efficient in our transport and logistics, particularly given the fact that we are quite well export dominated and some of these exports will drive the economy. So I think a general shift of encouragement for the industry, facilities for training, apprenticeships, better networking with higher educational institutes as well. That to me is a good long-term measure. It won't be a quick fix. And I think the other thing I would highlight, and I would say this particularly around Grangemouth, is there aren't too many areas in Scotland, or in fact the UK, where we make things anymore. And we have to start encouraging people to make things again. So I was quite interested to hear the construction perspective that we need trading zones around our ports, around our manufacturing centres, and to capitalise on the skills and the expertise that people have in these areas. Grangemouth, largest petrochemicals complex in the UK, I would say, many skills, some great announcements by INEOS about investment. These are very important, but equally renewables is an area where we can give people opportunity to make things as well. So creating the capacity for renewables and the supply chain for renewables, these are all, I think, long-term measures which help to build resilience into our economy.
Thank you very much, Charles. Can I maybe ask you in, and then I'll come back to Andrew to finish, if that's okay.
I do have to make some progress, Ms. Hislop. If you put the question to the retail consortium, and then I'm going to move to
Colin Beattie. Okay, to you, and sorry, Andrew, I think we're getting cut off.
So, Mr. McDonald Russell.
Sorry, apologies. I was waiting for the microphone to magically open
thank
up.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question. I think probably that the first thing to say is it's not so much a surprise that there are resilience challenges now, it's that it took so long for it to happen. The last couple of years, the retail industry's faced structural change, it's faced the impact of the COVID pandemic and restrictions, and the impact of EU exit. Any one of those would be an enormous event for any industry to absorb. Taking on all three simultaneously has been has been really hard. Despite that, despite all the challenges, we're still seeing stock coming through. We're still seeing an industry that is able to respond. But I think what we've seen in recent weeks is that, you know, these pressures are becoming to a point where they are nearly impossible to bear. Now, in the very short term, in terms of the measures that would help, I think firstly, we've had support from, government on delivery hours, delivery times, allowing, you know, shops that don't have that thing. That's quite small, but actually quite important to ops. Obviously, in the last year, one of the big things that makes a difference in terms of our, operations is actually the shop worker protection legislation that's come through, giving a bit of protection to shop workers, enforcing a huge number of rules in difficult circumstances, and a bit of confidence and, quite frankly, a bit of morale support for people who've, had a really tough couple of years. I think the third one I'd probably come to on support is, as Martin said, on HGV drivers, we would agree that there's a need for a short-term fix, that no matter what we do to training, to testing, the investment my members are making, we simply can't magic up the necessary drivers we need for the next couple of months out of thin air. And we couldn't even, you know, take people who aren't fully trained or supported. That wouldn't be safe, I think, for anybody to be in that situation. So we would absolutely support that, some sort of, visa system or, support in that area. I think also it's probably worth acknowledging the recent delay to import restrictions from the European Union. That's really, really helpful on food and drink as well. That helps to keep supply chains kind of moving. But again, how we resolve some of those challenges is long term going to be pretty there. In terms of what, government perhaps in the medium term can be doing, it's about giving the industry a bit of time to breathe. It's about, you know, looking at some of the measures that perhaps the government might like to do. There's discussion, for example, about a ban on New Year's Day trading. We have the potential deposit return scheme coming in next year. There's quite a lot of these areas where I think we need to have a pretty candid discussion about, whilst these are, perhaps virtual or maybe good or not things, is this the time to put increased burdens? We see lots of tax measures, for example, the UK government's proposals on national insurance. All of these things are, adding more costs at exactly the point businesses are under enormous, enormous pressure. And I guess finally, to kind of just finish, the two biggest things our industry probably could do. One is this coherency from governments, and the retail strategy the Scottish Government are working on at the moment is a great opportunity to, develop that up here. And finally, it's a bit of economic growth. The single biggest thing that will help the retail industry is if we can get the economy moving again, get people out about, get a little bit of that growth. And that, tends to see concurrent rise in sales. A lot of our challenges go away if we can get a bit more growth and productivity. Without that, it's going to be a really hard couple of years.
Thank you. Thank you. Colin Beattie, to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to look a little bit about how industry is actually absorbing the increased cost of freight and transportation. And I'd like to look maybe at some of the major components of that. Charles Hammond's already indicated the, or shown us the exponential price increase for a container coming from the Far East, moving from $2,000 to $20,000. Now, during COVID, we were told that because of COVID, what's happened is the transport system has been discombobulated, and that the, all the containers in the wrong place, and all sorts of fallouts from that, and that, would gradually rectify itself over a period. And yet, when I look, I don't know whether that's happened, and I'd appreciate a comment on that, but the UK Department of Transport has indicated that, in fact, compared to pre-COVID, volumes of freight to the UK have actually dropped by 10%. Now, is that due to reduced demand? Is it because of lack of ability to get a hold of containers and to ship to the UK? Perhaps I can get a little bit of information on that, and maybe Charles Hammond might be able to enlighten us.
Question. I think when you look at the freight statistics across the UK, a lot of that decrease also is as a result of issues between the short straits, the channel down in England. And what we're seeing as well as a result of Brexit is also a move from accompanied driver, accompanied freight coming from the EU towards unaccompanied freight. So I don't think the decrease in freight is quite as large as 10% as we stand today, because there is an element of recovery. But what we're also seeing is a movement from accompanied freight, particularly into unaccompanied container routes. It's probably, so we're absorbing those changes at the same time I think you're right to say empty containers aren't always in the right place. And that's quite an important issue for Scotland in particular because of the export domination of our trade. So finding cost-effective ways of repatriating empties is something that we're constantly aware of and looking at. And the answer isn't always to drive those across the country. Sometimes the answer is to ship them and to store them. And that's why we're creating more storage opportunities, if you like. So I think this is going to, at the moment, we don't see trends which are set in stone. I suppose it's fair to say we're still in that process of recovery, but we are going to see changes in supply chains, and I suspect also a more regional pattern, also the haulage and a greater use of rail. These are all things which are featuring at the moment in how we're handling trade.
Just looking at, you were talking about Brexit and the impact with EU trade. There's also mention made of congestion in our ports, which, again, if the volumes are down 10%, why is it that we're not coping? Why is it we're not able to handle it when there's a reduced volume?
So I think you can't take the 10% as being across every single port. So that move from a company to unaccompanied means that for a lot of ports, volumes aren't actually down 10%. I would say in terms of our operations, our volumes are higher at the moment than they were at the same time last year. In addition to that, because we're holding more stock in the ports, it means that the density of container stacks has increased by at least 20-30% in that period as well. So this move I was talking about from just in time to just in case means more stocking, and therefore for longer stay boxes we have to create outside storage areas to make sure that product flows through. So there are congestion issues, predominantly I would say probably at Felixstowe as a deep sea port. But for a number of the other ports around the country, I don't think those congestion issues are being managed with higher levels of stock on the ground.
Just to pick up on what you mentioned there about the increased volume of freight over last year, the Department of Transport says that freight increased by 13% compared to 2020, but is down 10% compared to 2019, the comparable periods there. Now, you're saying that the issue about port congestion is focused on Felixstowe. Why is that?
I think, again, it's the size of vessel going into Felixstowe, the amount of facilities available, and the fact that boxes are staying around longer, and I think the aftermath of the Suez grounding as well, are all, if you like, issues. And as well as that, and I think we've sort of heard about the trend away from retail, massive growth in e-commerce and people buying things online as well.
Can I maybe ask Martin Reid to come in, and maybe since the haulage industry moves the containers around, what's your take on that?
I'm certainly not going to argue with anything that's been said there. Experts and far cleverer than I am. I know from feedback from members that, particularly in the southern ports, there's been greater delays in moving goods, greater waiting time. Part of that, I guess, is because there are skill shortages right across the board, and I don't think. Warehousing numbers are down as well in terms of the staff working there because of the issues that we've already outlined. So, it's a concern, but the industry that we have, there's a reason why road haulage has the hegemony, and it's because it is flexible and nimble enough to cope with issues such as this. But, I know that the southern ports have had difficulties. And I guess the easements that were due to come in, additional checks that were due to come to incoming goods at the start of next year, now that they've been delayed, and it gives us as a country more time to try and get the flow of goods moving better than it currently is.
Maybe just coming back to the first thing I mentioned about industry and business absorbing the increased costs of freight and transportation. Maybe Ewan McDonnell-Russell can maybe comment on that from his perspective.
Thank you. Yes, very happy to. I guess in our industry, there's two elements. The first one is that costs are predominantly being kept down by competition. So last month, despite the fact that fashion has been a really hard hit category, fashion prices were down, I think, 9% in our shop price index. And that's because of like price cutting between people desperate to get some sales. So we're seeing that competition thing is putting that kind of a cap, if you like, on the top of price increases and the ability to pass it on because retailers are still very much there. Bluntly, that is waning, and that's partly waning because the models in place have proved too difficult for some retailers. We know some big department stores simply no longer trade. And what we're seeing also is that the way that costs are being absorbed at the moment through other ways, we're seeing fewer shops, often kind of fewer workers in those, and that shift to digital. Digital is not a more profitable platform, but it is a much cheaper platform to be able to operate because you don't have the same property costs and you can be more tech efficient, more productive. So those things are where some of those kind of costs are going at the moment. But as we've said, how long that can be done for what's left to be able to absorb those things, particularly in light of we're seeing increased transport costs, as others have articulated, distribution centres, again, that there are rising wages there because of labour things, the ability to absorb that, I think, goes. That doesn't mean we're going to see a massive uplift in prices month on month. It's sticky price theory, I suspect, kicks in and that you'll see gradual increases as retailers see exactly what they can kind of manage to keep within the market. I think the other thing just on that terms of volumes though, certain volumes and certain products simply haven't been selling over the last 18 months. People's fashion sales is a good one. Nobody's really been buying formal wear because we've all got nowhere exciting to go. Nobody's buying smart shoes for the office because we're all wearing slippers in the house. And I think, you know, that does have an impact in terms of the ability to manage some of these things. We're not really fully open yet. And even now, because as we said, our sales are still below, we're not probably getting the same products through. You see businesses who have kept certain ranges and have simply reused things, spring ranges, not buying a new one, because of course, at the start of the year, we had no idea if shops would be open at all. So there's lots of these sort of very unusual things going through. Hopefully those will shake out, but that might have some quite big consequences for costs going down the line.
So what you're saying is that at the moment, the retail sector is absorbing the additional transport costs, and that's likely to continue, maybe with narrowing margins to the point where they have to increase. Would that be correct?
That's a much more articulate and succinct way of putting it.
Can I move on to Alexander Burnett? There's time at the end. Alexander Burnett. And Alexander is remote, so hopefully he's able to join us.
Thank you, Convene. Sorry, that's my microphone on now. Just a couple of questions for Andrew and one for Charles. So Andrew first, I don't know my register of interests around construction. It's over 2 years now since this committee, which I wasn't on in the last parliament, completed a lengthy and thorough inquiry into construction, culminating in a 92-page report with around 30 recommendations. Given that many of those recommendations from 2 years ago are addressing exactly the same problems that are being raised today, I just wonder if it'd be fair to say there's been little progress by the Scottish Government on those recommendations, and if there had been sufficient progress, it would have certainly have alleviated some of the issues we're facing today. I just wonder if you could comment on that.
I can indeed. Can everybody hear me and see me this time? Connections are back, hopefully. There has been a significant amount of progress. The Scottish Government and the construction industry have probably never been closer as a result of COVID. Having set up the Construction Leadership Forum and in 2019, and then over the course, or certainly 12 months ago, set out a recovery plan with almost 100 actions, a number of which have either been ticked off or are in the process of still being sort of worked through. I certainly feel that from our perspective, relationships have actually never been better. And actually, probably most importantly, the Scottish Government actually does understand the sector better than it ever has. one of the things that obviously COVID does do is it actually highlights just exactly how many different government departments and public sector bodies are actually impacted when you shut construction down. So, so I think the issues are very much the right people in government do know and understand the issues. The biggest one that we've not quite solved yet, I guess, is procurement. And we are trying very, very hard to try and move heaven and earth to actually try and get into kind of equivalents of median pricing and what have you to actually prevent this race to the bottom, which is obviously killing the industry. It's almost killing the hands that feed you. So all these extra warehouses and all these other kind of facilities that are going to be required for renewables actually do ultimately have to be built. You need to have a very buoyant and healthy industry to be able to sort of help deliver those and all the other net zero carbon initiatives. So it's I think we're nowhere near fixed whatsoever. I think some of it is not fixable by the Scottish Government at all. It's a global issue, as I highlighted earlier, and we're having to sort of operate within it. So I think the short term issues that we're actually trying to overcome are current projects where they are fixed term, fixed price, where clients are actually have got very little manoeuvrability to be able to help out on cost and time pressures. That's certainly hurting a hell of a lot of the industry, the vast majority of whom are SMEs within the supply chain. The new projects that are under development at the moment are having considerable issues when it comes to budgets, because essentially quite a number of materials have increased pricing wise to sort of give or take about 30% when you average it out. And that 30% increase is roughly about 10% overall when you take into account the fact that construction pricing isn't just about materials, it's about labour and other things too. So 10% increases in construction costs cannot be borne by the industry that only makes 1% margins. So there is some difficulties there. There is a real need for increased budgets, both in terms of current projects and new. But we have engaged hugely with the Scottish Government, the Economic Development Director in particular, Dermot Rattigan, Sharon Miller, and Elizabeth Stark have been excellent in terms of just trying to get to the bottom of what, if anything, they can do to assist.
Thank you. Yeah, delighted to hear that. I think it was one of the actual specific recommendations was improving our relationship. So it's good to hear something positive around that. On the other thing you mentioned this morning, you mentioned around issues around supply and procurement. You mentioned it again. You spoke earlier on specifically about radiators. I'm just wondering what other opportunities you've identified out there for the production of some of these products closer to home and what we can be doing to try and deliver some of those opportunities.
Yeah, that has been looked at. The difficulty, I guess, we have is just purely if you're looking at demand from a Scottish perspective, when you're putting manufacturing facilities in play, there isn't enough demand for construction, whether it be affordable homes, whether it be office buildings, hospitals, schools and what have you, to actually create facilities that literally just service Scotland. And that's the issue that we've got here is that we are we did have quite a number of manufacturing facilities that over the years have actually closed down because they weren't profitable, and it was more profitable and better from a lowest cost perspective to actually get your bricks, your blocks, your structural timber, etc. from elsewhere. So it ultimately does come down to money. I mean, there, if you're really wanting to drive the circular economy and drive manufacturing in Scotland, I guess there's going to be a recognition that maybe there are going to be some components that could and should be built in Scotland, but actually they're going to be slightly more expensive. But actually, when you look at that from a value for money perspective and a circular economy perspective, actually, and the reinvestment of the Scottish pound, it makes more sense to do that within Scotland. But most of the investment cases for any manufacturing in Scotland are very, very tight, just purely because they the demonstrating the demand potential within Scotland is a tricky one. Charles highlighted obviously the Scottish economy is is smaller than other countries do. And actually, if you're going on lowest cost currently, then actually it does make more sense to actually import rather than actually try and create things yourself.
Mr.
Burnett.
Final question.
Mr. Burnett, do you mind? I'm just going to bring Maggie Chapman in for a supplementary on that question, and then I'll come back to you to ask a question of Ewan. Thanks very much, Kate. Sorry to cut across you, Alex, like that. Andrew, you were talking there about the circular economy, and I was just wondering what your view would be if there was some kind of local content requirement to shorten supply chains, but also importantly to catalyse local manufacturing. Is there something in that space that the Scottish Government should be looking at to make sure that we have we have the drivers to make to ensure that we are supporting local manufacturing and driving up demand for it if demand is the issue?
Yeah, absolutely. We've been asking the government for assistance there. There are some slight difficulties when it comes to interpretations of European law in terms of what you can ask for within tenders and what you're able to do to encourage local involvement. And different countries take different approaches to the same law. But the approach that's been taken in Scotland at the moment is actually it's very, very difficult to actually try and be specific about that. But nobody's giving up. We're not giving up as an industry. And I know the Scottish Government aren't giving up as a route to trying to just encourage that very point you made.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Burnett, and then I'll bring in Michelle Thompson.
Thank you. I was just going to add at the end that I was very much in agreement with Andrew's last comments, and we could see additionality and environmental costs priced effectively. We wouldn't just be looking at some of the lowest cost imports. My final question is Charles, you mentioned the importance of developing economic zones around trade ports. I was wondering how disappointed were you to hear the Scottish Government reject working on the UK free ports, and how is this could affect yourselves?
Thank you. That's I think for me, it's always disappointing when the Scottish Government, the UK Government, weren't able to reach an agreement on this. And the reason that is a general disappointment is we've already launched the Thames Freeport, and it's quite an exciting venture. We understand how it works, and we're already starting to get inquiries and interested parties who will undoubtedly make and distribute goods down in the southeast of England. So for me, I think there's great potential, particularly in the Firth of Forth, to create an economic freeport style zone which attracts the type of incentives UK government have talked about. What form that takes, obviously, we'll need to wait and see. I don't have any detail, but we're still extremely keen to promote some kind of trading zone and freeport zone in the Firth of Forth, in whatever form that takes. In terms of the ambition, and I'll just leave you with this figure, our preliminary assessment indicates a Firth of Forth Freeport Greenport zone could create something round about 50,000 direct and indirect jobs.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, that's all.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson.
Good morning. I just want to address some questions to Charles Hammond, please. You made a comment earlier in this session about Scotland being peripheral to Europe, and I wondered, in terms of comparative shipping figures, now I don't know how up to date they are now, but some years ago there was reports that Reykjavik in Iceland, with a population of about 350,000, shipped as much as Grangemouth. What's the kind of current comparable, and what might be the reason for that?
So the reason for that is that Iceland to trade have to ship everything. In terms of Scotland, obviously, quite a lot of our trade is with England. In fact, I think it's around about 40-45%, I think was the last figure I saw. So there's obviously an easy way of transporting goods to England, which is usually by road or by rail. So by definition, because of our geographic connection within the UK to England, we will end up shipping less than average. And just to give you a stat to support that, 95% of goods worldwide are shipped But in Scotland, that percentage is down around about 70-75%. So I think that's probably the reason.
And in terms of the performance of all the ports you own, where does Grangemouth fit relative to all the ports? What ranking would you give it?
It's, well, 55% of our business is down south, 45% in Scotland, but Grangemouth is Scotland's largest port. So on that basis, I would say number two, but extremely important, not only for the Scottish economy, but for our group to be successful. And that's something we want to see grow.
In terms of the stats of your group, though, where does Grangemouth fit in all the measures that you would apply, particularly, I imagine, around profitability? Where does it fit? I don't mean relative terms to Scotland's economy. I mean relative terms to the group.
That would be the same answer. So it would be number two within the group.
I just wanted to clarify
for
that. Okay.
Volumes, revenues, etc.
And in terms of leakage, where stuff is shipped out of ports, some of your other ports down south, do you have a sense of what percentage that leakage is?
There are Scottish, if you're thinking about Scottish goods that then get exported from English ports, sometimes we are also shipping those goods to English ports. So we have feeder connections with both Felixstowe and London Gateway, because essentially most of Scotland's goods to the rest of the world other than Europe will have to be transshipped to meet the larger vessels that call at Felixstowe, London Gateway or Rotterdam. There are also rail services that ship, that move goods down to some of the deep sea ports, but also down to Tees Port. We have set up our own rail service and rail terminal at Grangemouth. So in terms of market share, I think our market share is about 40-45%. So there's certainly scope to increase that market share, but obviously there are also other container ports in Scotland, such as Greenock, and other ports within the UK handling Scottish exports, sometimes with assistance from us and sometimes, I guess, in competition with us. So it's difficult to put a figure in the leakage, but certainly if you said to me, can we grow our market share at Grangemouth, I would say to you, yes, we can, by greater investment, greater efficiency and more warehousing.
And funnily enough, you must have sensed what I was coming on to. My question was going to be for you to move Grangemouth to number one. What would you do? And in particular, what structural issues would you seek to overcome?
The issue we've got is Grangemouth is serving Scotland's economy. And Scotland's economy at the moment is going to be smaller than the southeast, which Tilbury serves. So sometimes it's a question of population. But in terms of, if we say to grow Grangemouth in isolation and move it forward, I think investment by ourselves, which we're doing, creating an efficient trading zone with great incentives around Grangemouth would also be something we would do, and also making our operations more data efficient, which is something we're currently working on as well, would be the three things I would highlight.
And just finishing off on that, in terms of the current structure of the owning company, does the level of debt leverage limit investment?
No, it does not. So our shareholders are long-term pension funds. Effectively, we are generating funds to pay people's pensions, and they're perfectly happy to invest in any proposition in the business directly or through long-term private placement bondholders who we have as well. So there is no capacity issue for investment in our group.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. We do have a few minutes. If the panel has anything that you feel you haven't been able to say this morning, you would like to... I do have a couple of supplementaries. I'll move to members. I'll take Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jamie Halco-Johnson.
Thank you, Clens. And sorry to jump in again like that. This is probably a question most appropriately directed at Andrew. Andrew, you were talking About the race to the bottom and the shift in risk from the public to the private sector, and also the need for investment in the construction industry more generally. I was wondering what is it that the Scottish Government could be looking at in terms of mitigating some of that shift in risk, and thinking about some of the broader issues around driving up demand around the retrofitting, the house building that we know we need to see. What is it about? What kind of thing is this space around a national construction company or something like that that allows us to focus and target investment and therefore limit that risk shift that you've described?
Yeah, I mean the Scottish construction industry actually has had, 50% of its income is derived from public sector procurement. So it has had a very sort of welcome amount of money being spent, which obviously it's then been having to deliver upon. And obviously never mind the kind of, I guess, the economic value that is created by spending that money, the added value, sort of social benefits that are achieved through new hospitals, schools, and what have you, is obviously needs to be fully considered too. So, I guess the big ask is this demonstrable pipeline continues, and it becomes more and more demonstrable in terms of actually what it is that the public sector genuinely want the construction industry to deliver on. That first and foremost needs to happen. We need to actually have a pipeline of projects which actually allows the industry and its supply chain and all the other manufacturers to actually understand and know what's coming forward and actually in what form, such that we can actually train the appropriate people, whether they're in manufacturing or whether they're on site, to make sure they've got the right skills, because a retrofit skill is completely different to a new build skill in terms of just what it is that you're trying to do. I guess the other big ask is actually, as much as this these huge swathes of money are being put into construction, is making sure it's being directly used, and it comes back to, I guess, your point, the economy. It's not just about putting money into construction, it's about putting money into construction in the right way that encourages the right behaviours. And I guess that's the bit that we've just not quite managed to get ourselves into an agreed position yet. But in partly because of just the complexity of it all. I mean, it's not as there's not been a lack of will on both parties, but you're genuinely trying to drive the economy, trying to actually do stuff that does help drive transformation, drive fair work. Huge amounts of investment into making sure that people put forward the right apprenticeship opportunities and what have you too. These all need to be part of the procurement process. And at the moment, we're still, irrespective as to whether it's sort of central government or devolved local authorities and what have you, there is still just this tendency to stick to what the industry has done for years, which is actually go out and get the cheapest tender you can, and we're looking after the public sector coffers the best we possibly can. And actually our view is that is just so kind of narrow focused, I suppose, ultimately, is whilst it might suit your own specific needs in that local authority, actually the wider implications are you're killing the industry further, you're not encouraging transformation. And there's a huge amount of digitization that needs to go on within the industry as well that just does not. The money is not there to actually facilitate that principle because of the drive for procurement in the way that we're doing it currently.
Thank you.
Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Thanks very much, Convener. Sorry about jumping in at the end. It's a question for Martin Reid. You talked about the shortage of available HGV drivers, an issue across that's a problem across Europe. Looking at some of the figures here that we had, the salary has reduced in terms of comparable with some other comparable salaries. I think it was supermarket cashiers it was cited against. But also, as we say, there's a large issue in terms of a shortage across Europe. If HGV drivers were added to the shortage occupation list, Why would Scotland, and why would the United Kingdom and say Scotland particularly, be an attractive destination for people to come here and work, given that, but also perhaps additional costs in terms of travelling here, additional costs in terms of living here? And what would your expectation be in the event that HGV drivers were added to that list? What would your expectation potentially be of numbers?
Thank you for the question. In terms of numbers, it could be anything. At the end of the day, there are no positions in logistics on the shortage occupation list at all. As the numbers that I said earlier, it does seem crazy that that's the case, because there are shortages not just in HGV driving, but right through the sector. Just by law of averages, we should have at least one position on that. But at the end of the day, that's not necessarily going to be the panacea that we'd hoped it would be, because basically, Europeans are finding it easier to live and work in other parts of Europe now. So there is no guarantee they will want to come back. But one of the reasons that we want HGV drivers to be on the shortage occupation list is that it's another avenue. And as I said at the start, there is no one silver bullet that's going to cure this. What we need is a number of solutions. I'd like to return to a point that Charles made earlier on about the promotion of the industry through the government. And the UK government, the Scottish government, Irish and Welsh, we're all in the same position here. And so we need to look at the rhetoric that comes out when we're talking about the industry. In a lot of different releases, trucks are seen as big, dirty, smelly things. And that's no longer the case since the Euro 6 engine came out in 2013. The industry has dropped its emissions by about 75%, which is more than any other industry. So we need to show, we need all levers to be pulled to try and get more people in. We, as an organisation, have a National Lorry Week that, conversely, is going to run over a month. But the activities will be a week in each country, and we will be doing in Scotland the last week in October. But I would encourage the members of this committee and any of your party members to help by dropping a 20-second iPhone message, just to say that you support the industry. And that it's a career that should be of choice. It offers a lot of different opportunities and a lot of different options, just so we can get this message out through social media to try and attract people to come in. So the shortage occupation list is a lever. It's not a silver bullet, but we would welcome all the levers being pulled to try and alleviate the immediate problems.
Okay, many thanks for that, Martin.
Thank you. I'll take one final question from Colin Beattie.
Vera, just a quick one for Andrew Richards. Just to ask much the same question about the ability of the industry to absorb not just the freight and transportation costs, which obviously are common to all, but the specific extremely high increases in raw materials that have been identified in the construction industry. Is the industry absorbing that? Is it already passing it on to its customers? How is it coping?
The answer is, I guess, a bit of everything. The current projects that were already procured but were still to be built out were essentially procured on fixed term, fixed price contracts, and a lot of pain and angst has been taken by the industry. And unfortunately, there are a few casualties off the back of that, administrations, etc. In terms of projects that are currently in procurement, the specialists in terms of your architects and your designers, as well as the construction specialists themselves, are trying very, very hard to mitigate these cost increases by designing some of the more expensive materials out. Designing out some of the materials that, okay, they're not expensive, but actually there's an availability issue, to try not to get deliverability as much as you possibly can. Now that sometimes means getting rid of the nice to haves and just leaving the buildings that you're actually creating just being on the kind of the need to have types of structures. It does require the public sector procurers and the construction industry teams to be working very, very closely to try and actually mitigate that. But you know, in terms of, you know, a 10% increase in overall construction costs, i.e. a 30% increase in materials, just cannot be taken on by the industry, who mostly earn 1% margins.
Can I just confirm what you're saying really is the industry is substituting quality for utility in terms of the construction it's delivering?
I guess ultimately it depends on your definition of quality, but what they are trying to do is actually use measures that exist and levers that exist to actually try and get projects back into budgets that allow the project to still go ahead. So I don't think any shortcuts are being taken in terms of how the guys ultimately on the ground are wanting to deliver. They're not taking any shortcuts in terms of structural risks in terms of what they build. This is more about sort of the final specification within buildings, where maybe some of the nice to have specification is, gold taps are now silver taps, for example, or just, areas where you genuinely can actually just still have the same level of quality, but it's just not quite at the price that was envisaged originally.
Okay, thank you very much to all the panellists. That brings the evidence session to a close. I would like to thank Charles Hammond, Ewan MacDonald-Russell, Martin Reid and Andrew Richards for attending this morning and speaking to the committee. That concludes the public part of the meeting, and we will now move into private session.